So good afternoon everyone. For my dissertation work, I was pretty sure from the beginning that I would love to work on human wildlife conflict, because human wildlife conflict imparts imparts threat to existence of wildlife species. And it's a very broad topic, because humans are in constant conflict with different herbivores and carnivores. But I specifically looked at elephants, because they cause a very large-scale destruction, whether it be crop property damages or human casualties. So we know that India holds a population of around 27,000 elephants, and along with our human population of 136 billion. And out of the east central and the southern Indian landscape, which holds elephant population, according to the last 3 years estimate, it was found that the per capita human casualties were highest in the state of Assam. So I focused just on that. And it obviously causes it imparts a sense of retaliation among the minds of people, because of which they are often violent towards the elephant. And it's actually very devastating to see that how people have to live with the fear of encountering elephants on a day-to-day basis. Because of which prominent literature emphasized on the importance of looking at the impacts of different mitigation measures for controlling human elephant conflict. And a report by Ajay Desai also emphasized that physical barriers is a great mitigation tool for reducing human elephant conflict, but an assessment of the efficiency of the same is still lacking in the Asian context. And it is also important to emphasize on the importance of social aspects in terms of the elephant conflict. So if you were to look at different works done in the state of Assam in regards to human elephant conflict, quite a lot of work has been done, but mostly nobody assessed the efficacy of the physical barriers which are present in the landscape. So I intended to do the same, and I assessed the efficiency of physical barriers such as solar fence and fence in the Bolaga district of Assam. Now I had three major research questions in my mind. The first was that whether the intensity and extent of the human-elephant conflict was, whether it was dispersing or was concentrated to certain pockets within the district. And second was to assess the efficiency of the physical barriers to restrict the movement of elephants in the human-use area. And the third was to look at how the local people perceive these mitigation strategies that involve the physical barriers. My study site was one of the central districts of Assam, which is the Bolaga district. So as you can see, it has a interstate location located between Assam and Nagaland. So basically located in Assam and shares the boundary with Nagaland. And the district of Nogaon on the west and the district of Kalganglong on the southwest, and these three districts as a whole makes up one of India's largest elephant reserve, the Kaziranga Kalganglong Elephant Reserve, spanning across the area of 3,270 km². So on the west, the district has Kaziranga National Park, where I could identify two villages which had solar fence, two which do not have that barrier. And for the southwestern part, Nambo Dolgurung Wildlife Sanctuary was present, in which I located one village which had an elephant proof fence, and the other, this one, did not have that barrier. And this is the solar fence in the Auratoli Range of Kaziranga National Park, and this is the fence in the other study site. For my study design, first of all, I did a reconnaissance survey, and I identified villages along with the GPS location. These villages were chosen based on the absence and presence of barriers, the high reports of human elephant conflict, and similar habitat characteristics in terms of the forest and the accessibility. And these were done with the opinions from local conservationists and forest officials. further, as I already mentioned, I identified solar surfaces and elephant footprints. And I did a science survey, details of which I'll explain further. And to look at the spatio-temporal trend over the decade, that is 2010 to 2019, I procured the historic mountain reports from the Assam Forest Department. And along with that, I also did semi-structured questionnaire surveys in my study village. So for the methods which I implemented to check the efficiency of the barrier, suppose this is a solar fence. This is a solar fence in the Kathmandu National Park. Then it started, suppose from point A to point B. The length of the solar fence was 4.2 km. And this blue line represents the stretch of 4.2 km. Then I divided this stretch into three equal segments which I call transits. And each transit was 1.4 km long. And each transit had 7 sampling units. And the distance between two sampling units was 200 meters. Then I walked in those transits parallel to the barrier looking for signs of elephants such as elephant dung and elephant footprints. I also looked for site covariates such as distance of the forest from the barrier, distance of settlement from the barrier, distance of nearest tree, and the different types of crops that were grown in the sampling units, and observation covariates such as age of the setting. And similar processes were also conducted in the non-barrier site for the solar fence. Method was applied for the trench, except for the fact that the trench was only 2 km long. So I divided into two transects of 1 km length each, and it had 5 sampling units, which was again the distance between the two sampling units was 200 meters. And I collected the same covariates along these transects and looked for elephant signs. For the questionnaire survey, I asked people semi-structured questionnaires. Questions, and I also conducted open discussions with major groups and interviewed various village defense parties and NGOs to get an overall picture of the involvement of every stakeholder in human elephant conflict. I did a systematic sampling wherein if a village had less than 100 households, then I tried to cover 30% of the entire village. And if the village had more than or equal to 100 households, then I covered 20% of them. The questions that were asked included the people's view on OCC, the losses they faced, the changes in the conflict instances pre and post deployment of the barrier, and their willingness to pay for maintenance of the barrier and other different conflict and social conflict related things. For assessing the perception of people, I used their willingness to pay for maintenance of the barrier as a proxy, and I identified three categories. The first category was the category 1, in which it belonged to people who were unwilling to pay for maintenance of the barrier because either they lacked interest or they thought that it's solely the responsibility of government to do intended work. And then the second category belonged to people who were unwilling to pay due to their low income. And the third category belonged to people who were actually willing to pay for the maintenance of the barrier. Now the amount of money which people were intending to pay was calculated by a double bidding method, in which the bid started from a very low value of rupees 10. And then I asked them about the maximum and the minimum amount of money they could pay. And then the bidding ended with a no, which meant that the people cannot, they will not be able to pay further than that. Okay, and on a total, I did 249 interviews, 122 in the barrier site and 127 in the non-barrier site. For my analysis, for the visual representation of the spatial and global center of the conflict over the decade, I did an optimized hotspot analysis in ArcGIS using the tool Getis or Statistics. So I had to input feature classes which were my village polygons and the conflict data records between the decades over the decade. For visualizing it on a simpler level, I divided that time period in five time period intervals, starting from 2010 to 11 and so on. The mechanism of this tool is basically that it compares the conflict incidence of a particular village with respect to the mean conflict incidences of the entire district as a whole. And if that value is higher than that of the mean, then it is considered as a high conflict hotspot, having a confidence interval of 95% or above. For assessing the efficacy of barriers, I compared the means of barrier and non-barrier sites with respect to their encounter rates based on Welch's ANOVA and Gaines-Howell post-hoc test. And then for assessing people's perception, I ran multinomial logistic regression, and both of them were done in the software RStudio. As for the results of conflict hotspots for crop property damages, I found that on an average, 81 villages were high conflict hotspots for over the decade. Similarly, an average of around 70 villages were identified as conflict hotspots for the district over the decade. And for human casualties, an average of 71 villages were identified as conflict hotspots. So here we can see that the extent and the intensity of the conflict were not dispersing, they rather were concentrated along concentrated in pockets just around the protected area. And it may be because of absence of elephants beyond those extent, and also increasing density of urbanized area. And it's actually very good because strategically then it will be much easier to impart management applications in that district. As for the results of my Welch's ANOVA, I found that there was a significant difference between the means of barrier and the non-barrier areas. And the encounter rate of solar fence was significantly relatively lower than the fence site. And the results from the Gaines-Howell test indicated that there was a significant difference between the means of solar fence and barrier, which meant that solar fence, with respect to the encounter rates, solar fence was actually effective in reducing the human conflict in the district to a certain extent. Then for my the result of my multinomial regression, my best fit model for the unwilling category shows that in case of increase in HAC instances for the barrier and the non-barrier site, the unwillingness of people was decreasing. So people were willing to invest in a barrier, and with increase in, like, if the people were provided with compensation, then again people were willing to invest in the barrier. And if the time taken for the compensation increased, then people remain unwilling to invest in the barrier due to their, either their lack of interest or they thought that the barrier might not be functional. Sorry, they had a distrust on the authorities. And for changes in elephant dispersion rates and crop rate frequency changes, for the barrier site, it was seen that people were actually willing to invest in the barrier, whereas for the other side, it was completely the opposite. For the willingness to take category, in both the barrier and the non-barrier side, people were losing interest to invest in the physical barriers because they might think that the barrier is unable to sustain the conflict or reduce the conflict basically. And in case of if compensation was provided to people in the area of the barrier, then people were willing to pay further for the barrier. But in case of compensation for the non-barrier area, since people were getting compensated, so they did not feel the need to invest in the barrier. Right. And with the increase in time taken for compensation, it was found that in the barrier areas, people were actually unwilling to pay due to their distrust in the functionality of the barrier. And complete opposite results are seen in case of crop grading frequency and elephant incursion changed in the barrier, in the non-barrier side. So this meant that people were actually, they wanted barriers in this site so that the amount of incidence of conflict can be reduced in their area. For management implications, in the area, I noticed that the solar fences were discontinuous in some parts, and they were on non-uniform length across the entire stretch. And for trenches as well, the depth and the width, of the trench varied in different parts of the entire stretch. And in some areas, it was, the trench was also even filled up. This might be because of high siltation issue in the landscape of that district. And people also personally invested in low water solar fences and trenches with, which were around 9 feet deep around their houses. And NGOs also provided provisions like makeshift machines and providing torches which were portable, rechargeable, and had a beam of which can go up to 2 km range. And capacity building in terms of training for handloom and mushroom cultivation and vermicomposting were also provided to decrease the dependence on agriculture. As a way forward, from my study I can suggest that lemon cultivation along the fringe villages of the protected areas can be effective, because generally elephants tend to avoid those areas. And community fencing has been a success in the Tarai landscape, and it's also cost effective and needs very minimum maintenance. So similar can be implemented in the district, provided an assessment is done prior and post to that. And also conflict concentrated training to the village defense parties would be imparted. And this is the hanging solar fence which has been installed in the park boundaries of Mudumala Tiger Reserve and Manas National Park as well. And same has been initiated in the Kathmandu National Park. So it would be very nice to see that how this would function. And it's very important to also emphasize on community awareness and educating the youth to inspire the minds to conserve the species. Apart from that, a combination of barriers such as the elephant tooth fences and the solar fence put together can be an effective way. An equal representation of the stakeholders is also very important. And it was noticed that most of the people in the area did not apply for compensation because it was a very cumbersome process, and that's why simplification of compensation application process is necessary. Apart from that, this will also bridge the communication gap between the forest department and the local communities. And strengthening of harmless traditional mitigation measures and inclusion of early warning systems can also help in reduction of human elephant conflict in the district. And with this, I want to thank all the lovely people for helping with my dissertation, and without whom my study would not have been possible. Thank you so much. Was built in or installed in 2007, so I didn't data, and because I considered only from 2010 to 2019, and for the solar trends, it was developed recently in 2020, so I did not have that data.
So, this is a very interesting presentation. You have a lot of information from the past and collected some information yourself. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, I said it's a very interesting presentation. You have a lot of information from the past as well as some data you collected yourself. The question is, you know, you sampled a solar fence line of maybe 4 kilometers, is it?
Yes, right?
Yeah. And then a trench line of 2 kilometers.
What is it?
A trench line of 2 kilometers.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So do you think those, I mean, that length is enough for you to assess in terms of, you know, whether that length justifies the variability along that landscape of elephant use and variable elephant use, variable density of elephants, variable people density, you know, and economic status and whatever. So how do you sort of justify that part and, you know, of your sampling in terms of elephant conflict mitigation measures and its comparison, you know, given all these variables in the particular landscape?
So, sir, of course, it's not enough for elephants. Because it's a very smaller area to decide it at. But when I tried to look at different physical barriers which were available in the district, I could find only these barriers apart from the Himalayan wall which was there. But I could not assess that due to lack of permission. So I did not have any other ones.
Yeah, so I would suggest that, you know, maybe if you, within the ambit of your data collection and within all of that, maybe you could try to segregate those aspects and see whether, you know, the question is it effective or not, is the main question. And the efficacy of a particular method depends on the situation at that particular instance. Okay, so it may change. It may be that solar fences may not be effective somewhere else, you know, because the situation there is different. Okay, and yeah, so that's what you need to capture in that, and then you need to suggest appropriate measures at certain sites best suited for that site. Right, that is one aspect of it. And the socioeconomic data, whatever recommendations you gave, were they recommendations from the data that you looked into, or were they general recommendations?
Sir, those were recommendations I collected as generalized also, and also that were suggested in guidelines which were provided by the ministry for reducing.
That's fine. I mean, they give general guidelines, but with respect to your study and respect to your site, I think you need to be more specific in terms of what you studied, what you found, what you recommend. These general guidelines everybody knows, so keep them as a general guideline, but the specific you need to, because this general, after doing so much of study, then you go back to the general guidelines and it downplays your own study, right? So I think you need to stick to what you found and what you think is best for the particular thing, right? Okay, thank you.
You came out good, Akar. My question is, it's rather a comment. I suspect this conflict zone has populations of elephants coming from different parts of the region. There are some elephants coming from Nagaland. Yeah? Okay, so I'm saying that the conflict issue, the conflict scenario that you see there is pertaining to elephant populations coming from different parts, from different populations from across that region. Some coming from Nagaland, some coming from Kargi and Longtail, some possibly from Meghalaya. So, I think you needed to have a better understanding of what these populations are, from where they are coming. Okay. Otherwise, these comments, these recommendations, it's very generic. And also, all of these elephants, they are headed down to the to Kaziranga. Okay. So, which was their original routes? Much of that corridor is fragmented and broken. So, all of these conflicts will be there. There will be any number of studies. These conflicts will be there. Everyone will come up with suggestions, but that's not that. So, as from a research point of view, if you could predict which are those areas where there is still a possibility of maybe restoring a corridor, okay? I mean, I might be digressing quite from what you had originally planned, but I'm broadly saying from the conflict point of view. And this really requires some amount of research on elephant populations and their behavior, how they're using this area. Okay, thank you.